Change readiness assessment. This estimates the organization's preparedness to transition to a new way of working. Considers many factors that can impact ability to adapt to change. Helps to direct activities in areas likely to improve change success. And lastly, can help to identify potential change agents. So as the name states, change readiness, being ready for a change. While going for a change may be attractive proposal, but is the organization ready for it? And usually they may look at the past track record of successful changes. If the past record is good, they may be ready for another change. Sometimes there may be too many changes which have happened and that could have caused a change fatigue. People are tired of it. So in that case, doing one more change could prove to be a failure. So overall, such factors should be considered. Other things to be considered could be, what is the experience in handling similar changes in the past? What is the capacity once the change happens? Does the organization have resource capacity to continue with the change? For example, if there is an improved support procedure, does the operations readiness exist for the personnel who can support in a new manner? Yeah, and are they capable of handling the changes in the support system? It's not just about changing something, but the ability to continue to handle it afterwards for a longer period. And sometimes it could be a cultural aspect. Changes may not fit into the culture. A company which is a very traditional way of working, if they want to suddenly move into lots of new things at the same time, like high technology, agile and all that, it may not be the company culture. And people may start leaving, or people may have doubts about it. They may want to see small demos and try that gradually before really formally doing changes. And it also depends a lot on the current support system. How are the current departments? Are they willing to be participating in it, or can they handle such a change? How is the workflow's flexibility? Yeah, I mentioned that a while ago. Lots of such things. Even if the current operational performance is not good, is it okay to go ahead and change it? Or should we wait until the operations is at least a little bit stabilized before we can change it and improve it? So it may link to other aspects in service management also. Changing one area may impact another area. And what about if third parties are involved in the service activities? So if you change something, then how about aligning those third parties also for those changes? So a lot of factors may come in when doing a change ready, for being change ready. And therefore this assessment includes a deep analysis of all these aspects. Next one is customer or user satisfaction analysis. Sometimes there is customer satisfaction analysis, which is given by the customer a feedback, and sometimes individual users will also be asked for feedback. How customers or users feel about the services they use based on feedback. Valuable input for most improvement initiatives. Usually the service management organization exists for the purpose of satisfying customers and meeting their needs, providing value to them. Therefore, this becomes a key assessment tool. When iterative changes are planned, it is important to monitor this and validate the impact of each change iteration, which means when changes are happening frequently, iteratively, then the feedback must be taken at those frequent intervals. Customer journey, customer experience, customer satisfaction are likely to be different to different users. May need to talk to different people, therefore, and we need to take a different approach to assessment and analysis. Okay. There are many well-known customer satisfaction analysis methods like satisfaction surveys in particular. Some of them are subjective, some are objective. One of the well-known method is the NPS, Net Promoter Score. Though Net Promoter Score is explained in the DPI manual from Excellos, it is not part of the exam syllabus. However, in case you are aware of it, it is basically about, it's a very good way of capturing customer satisfaction, because it does not directly ask whether they are satisfied, but they ask only one question: whether the customer or user is likely to recommend us to other customers. Which means when they are going to recommend to others, they better be careful when they recommend. So it's going to be a very good feedback when they say yes or no there. And the method works wherein there are promoters and detractors. Promoters mean those customers who said yes, we are likely to recommend to others. And detractors means they're saying no, we are not likely to recommend. However, there is a score there on a scale of 1 to 10 or 0 to 10. If they have picked up the higher values for recommendation, they're known as promoters. And those who have picked up lower scores for recommending, they're known as detractors. In general, 0 to 6 is detractors. And 9 or 10 only out of 10 is the promoter. So a difference is taken between the number of promoters and the detractors to get the overall net promoter score. The percentage, you know, the percentage of promoters from the total minus the percentage of detractors from the total 100% who have responded to the survey, that gives the net promoter score, which means the promoters need to be high, the detractors need to be less to get an overall good score. And other things generally what they use in such satisfaction surveys is one has to be cautious, because the culture also impacts the feedback. In certain cultures, it may be okay to put some direct feedback. In certain cultures, they may want to beat around the bush and give some other feedback. Yeah, and also the use of words can be tricky. In some cultures, they may use words like amazing. They may want to give feedback like amazing or terrible, you know, just two opposites. But in some cultures, they may not use those words at all. They may use words like, even if they're fully happy, they will say, okay, we are okay. Or they may say, we are fine. And in some cultures, they may say amazing or terrible. So it is important to understand what do these words really mean for different customers. So when somebody is saying okay, it can mean that they are extremely satisfied. Yeah, so those are the things to watch out for. Now, with that, let's look at some of the pros and cons. The pros are provides insights on value of products and services and trust in the service provider. Monitor perceptions of organization's commitment to the service relationship. Allow organization to see how perceptions change over time, which means regular surveys could be done, analysis could be done. And if the result is not okay, then it can indicate how the relationship will become. The disadvantages are too many surveys lead to fatigue and inaccurate scores. Follow-up to surveys may be seen as selling and be ignored. Responses may be strongly influenced by the exact timing of feedback request. When the feedback form is sent, if it is sent in a very difficult time or a stressful time or when things are really bad, then all the good work done in the previous months may not be acknowledged. And when people are following up, it might indicate to the person responding to the survey that the follow-up is just to get the survey results and market the scores to the market or demonstrate the scores to the market. So one has to be careful.